Good evening. I'm presenting from Medicine 2. This is about Mr. M, who is a 35-year-old businessman from Bihar, who has presented with the following complaints. That's fever for the past 1 month, which is low-grade, intermittent, and right side shoulder pain with restriction of joint mobility for the past 10 days. So otherwise, there's no history of cough or breathlessness or any pleuritic chest pain. There's no history of abdomen pain, dysuria, abdominal distension, or any GI bleeding. So he was recently found to have diabetes and is on medications for the same from the outside hospital, from a local place. He consumes a mixed diet. He doesn't have any addictions like smoking or intake of alcohol. So at arrival, his vitals-wise, pulse rate was 110 beats per minute, BP of 160, 100 by 60, respiratory rate of 18 per minute. He was febrile when he presented to us with a temperature of 104 degrees Fahrenheit. And he, on general examination, he had a left axillary lymph node, which is of 2 into 2 centimeters. So on systemic examination, the respiratory system, normal vascular breath sounds were heard, CVS, S1, S2 present, the abdomen was soft, CNS, no focal neurological deficit. Musculoskeletal examination wise, there is a right shoulder swelling with severe joint line tenderness, and there is a severe restriction of the movement of the right shoulder, around the right shoulder, and there is also the wasting of muscles present on the right shoulder. Elbow movements, however, were noticed to be normal, and the pulses, peripheral pulses, were well felt. So he also has left knee swelling that was noticed during the examination of the other joints. However, there were no complaints of other joints that were told by the patient. So the differentials at that point of presentation that were considered were whether it's a disseminated tuberculosis because of the fever which is going on for the past 1 month, and two oligoarthritis, there is two joints being involved, or whether it's a amyloidosis with bone and joint involvement, or whether it's a infective endocarditis with septic emboli to the joints, or whether it's a brucellosis.
So I will interrupt you. She had cardiovascular findings, so there were murmurs?
No murmur, ma'am.
Any splinter hemorrhages or rods for?
No, ma'am. No peripheral signs of infective endocarditis.
Okay.
So other condition may be less common, being considered the gender, systemic lupus erythematosus, whether it's a disseminated malignancy like leukemia or lymphoma was considered. So he was evaluated for the same. He has anemia which was microcytic, hemoglobin of 7.9, counts however were normal, 8000 with neutrophils of 67. Platelets were normal, LFTs showed mild transaminitis with a SGOT-PT of 54 and 96. Creatinuria were normal, electrolytes were normal, BBVS was negative, malarial parasite and Brucella antigen were done, which were both negative. Echo was done, which was normal, which did not show any features of vegetation, which did not show any vegetations. So blood culture was done, which has grown gram-negative bacilli, Buckholderia, pseudomallei. So MRI right shoulder was done because of the severe pain, which has shown osteomyelitis involving the right humerus with evolving intramedullary abscess also with septic arthritis and myositis with the intramuscular abscess. So osteomyelitis being the primary presentation in melioresis. So there's a study which is done, which is a Darwin study. The most common presentations of melioresis being pneumonia, which is almost 50%, genitourinary tract, which is 14%, skin infection is also common, 13%, whereas bacteremia without any focus is almost 11%. Whereas if you see septic arthritis or osteomyelitis, it accounts to 3 to 4%. So this is a study which was done. It's a prospective study which is done in the northern region of Australia in the hospital of Darwin, who looked at it's a retrospective study which was looked at multiple cases from October 1989 to 2009. So they have taken patients who were culture proven melioresis. There were almost 536 patients during that 19. They have looked from 19 years and 4 months. So among that, they have seen how many people actually have presented with the primary septic arthritis, so that accounted to about 2.4% according to the literature. Like according to this study, it was almost 2.4%. Whereas the patients who was presented with primary osteomyelitis, they were 1.3% among those people. So whereas the patients with primary melioidosis with the septic arthritis which had as a secondary part was almost 2.6% of the all people. So this is something which show the primary joint melioidosis with the primary melioidosis being a focus elsewhere. So the male population, when we see, it's almost 50% of the male population are noticed to have developed, I mean the patients who have developed, they're almost 50% predominant of the male people, whereas in primary melioidosis it's a little higher than what, it's 70%. Whereas diabetic mellitus becomes the more common factor that can actually make them prone to infection, being 50% in the group with primary melioidosis, whereas that is joint involvement, whereas the other people that were almost 40%. So even the septic shock, when we saw this thing, it was like almost 20% population. It's more or less equal, like both people in the broad group are 20% prone to get into ICU. Whereas the primary and primary or secondary bone and joint melioidosis versus melioidosis elsewhere. So this is also predominantly male is 50%, whereas it's more predominant when it is origin is a different place. So actually the treatment of this would be ceftazidim, as we all know, but whereas in non-pulmonary infections we tend to give ceftran along with the ceftazidim because of the property of the penetration into the joints and the intracellular activity that ceftran has. So in our patient, he underwent a debridement and a serial intramedullary reaming and washout of the right humerus. And debridement and a washout of the left knee was also done on 7th of October 2019. He received a course of 6 weeks of antibiotic along with the eradication phase with the trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole, and it was planned for 1 year minimum because he had a disseminated course. So the main thing I wanted to tell is we have also seen two more patients with similar complaints over the past 3 months. With the joint manifestation being a primary symptom of the melioidosis. So according to the literature, it is only 2.3%, but in our hospital, we have seen almost 3 patients over the last 3 months in medicine to unit. So it's not as rare as we were thinking. And the extensive treatment actually could save him a joint. So it was also, he was at a point where we had to, amputate. I mean, it was joint may not be salvaged. So extensive treatment like surgical and medical as soon as initiated would be required.
Can you please tell me how you found out it was not periarthritis of the shoulder due to diabetes, but it was a septic arthritis?
Ma'am, the cultures from the...
So any patient who comes with joint pain in your OPD, you're going to send cultures, wait for the results and decide it's Burkholder area or not?
No, ma'am, they can have other presentations also.
Yeah, so you have to have a clinical approach to your patient, which is what I said for Joel also. So yeah, the learning point will be like how to differentiate septic arthritis of the shoulder from a periarthritis, which is common in people who have got uncontrolled diabetes. So the main thing in septic arthritis will all range of movement would have gone. While in periarthritis, which one is affected? Yeah, you can learn it. So, yeah, Burkholder area does affect. Why was the study done in Darwin and not in India?
Because they have a lot of exposure and...
Okay, melioidosis is considered endemic to Australia. Though it is now even, it's common in India also. But the original thought is that it's common in Australia and Oceania is not. Thank you.